1779, Britain lost one of its greatest treasures, a stunning art collection, one of the finest in Europe. More than 200 paintings by some of the greatest artists in history, Rembrandt, Rubens, Van Dyck, Poussin. They were stripped from the walls of Houghton Hall in Norfolk and sold abroad, shipped over 1,000 miles away to St. Petersburg in Russia.
Awaiting their arrival with great anxiety was Tsarina Catherine II, Empress Catherine the Great of Russia. She acquired the private art collection of Britain's first Prime Minister, Sir Robert Walpole.
It was an artistic loss that was to cause public outrage in Britain. But for Catherine the Great of Russia, it would be the cornerstone of a great new collection that would confirm Russia as a civilized nation. This is the forgotten story of Russia's most celebrated empress, Britain's first prime minister, and how shifting family fortunes saw Britain lose one of its first great art collections. But now the paintings are coming home. The clock will turn back 234 years for one brief summer, when Houghton Hall will be reunited with its lost masterpieces. Houghton Hall in Norfolk, one of Britain's finest country houses. Like a great Roman temple set deep in the English countryside.
This magnificent building is a masterclass in the power of architecture, or perhaps to be more correct, the architecture of power. It's also, in many ways, a portrait of its age and of the man for whom it was built, Sir Robert Walpole, Britain's first Prime Minister.
Sir Robert Walpole was a political colossus of the 18th century. For more than 20 years, from the 1720s to the 1740s, he dominated public life. In many ways, he is the man who invented modern politics and the way cabinet government works today. He even gave 10 Downing Street to the nation as the official residence of the Prime Minister. Walpole was from a prosperous Norfolk family with his roots in trade and farming. But as he grew in power and prestige, he built Houghton Hall and its great estate to display his new place in the world. And Houghton was constructed not merely as a grand country house, but as a temple to the arts and learning. The library has barely changed since Sir Robert's day, and it remains a very direct expression of his power, prestige, and passions. There, a portrait of George I stares down. His books are largely still on the bookcases and the shelves here. Incredible. You can imagine him reclining here in his day bed, reading his state papers, looking at his books. Here you get a very direct and intimate sense of Sir Robert in his house in Houghton. There, of course, is his absolutely magnificent mahogany desk. Here, Sir Robert would have sat contemplating his idyllic landscape at this desk, essentially ruling the English-speaking world. Sir Robert's position and the grandeur of his lifestyle made him a controversial figure. Accusations of corruption, favoritism, and naked ambition swirled around him. he found himself mercilessly ridiculed by contemporary satirists who questioned the source of his wealth and the honesty of his political dealings. But despite these accusations, Walpole enjoyed the longest period of power of any British Prime Minister. He was a shrewd political operator who knew how decisive appearances could be. Walpole understood how to use his position of public power to his own private best advantage. He also recognised the power of art in creating and sustaining a strong public image. In the 18th century, an art collection was proof of cultural and social standing. For any aspiring politician, it was a vital tool, one that displayed his wealth and superior taste. But for Walpole, it went further. He wanted to shape national taste and inspire the arts in Britain to greater heights. So he set about building an art collection of the very highest quality. The way in which Walpole collected art demonstrates his network of power and influences. He had ambassadors and indeed spies out in Europe collecting political information, but they were also charged with keeping an eye open for good works of art. You've got to remember, at the time, paintings were a form of currency, and a good tip about an outstanding piece, well, could secure political advantages. Today, the impact and quality of Walpole's collection at Houghton Hall is suggested only by a set of engravings. These were commissioned in the 18th century to memorialise the lost pictures. These monotone images are all that's left here, a mere shadow of the once glorious collection. The real pictures, of course, had been sold, taken down from the walls and shipped abroad. The house was left naked, its meaning diminished. Rooms like this, the common parlour, lost more than a few paintings. They lost their soul. This was a house that had been conceived around the collection, and now a crucial part of Houghton was missing. Sir Robert had employed one man to oversee all the interior decoration. In 1725, he'd engaged the services of one of the most sought-after young painters and architects in Britain, William Kent. Kent combined classical elements to create a grand Roman palace. He drew on the inspiration of classical Rome and the art of antiquity. Designed, of course, with one aim in mind, to underline the power and prestige of Robert Walpole. There is a revealing portrait here of Sir Robert. Again, we see the sort of the tone of antiquity. He's dressed here as a Roman senator, very grand, but one touch not historically correct. He had to have his Roman toga and garb altered to reveal the Garter Star. He'd been awarded that in 1726. He just had to show it, didn't he? Rooms like this were designed to proclaim Walpole as a man of taste. But this grand entrance hall was a mere fanfare for what was to come, the great canvases. Drawings by William Kent from 1725 demonstrate something remarkable. Walpole's paintings were an integral part of the architectural scheme at Houghton, every bit as important as the mouldings and furniture. Houghton Hall was, in essence, conceived as a picture gallery, and a gallery built for a very specific collection of paintings. So now, for the first time in 234 years, the paintings, or at least those that can travel, are being reunited with the house. Over the next few weeks, Houghton will be restored to its former glory.
The man who's turning back the clock is the current owner. David Rock Savage, the 7th Marquess of Cholmondeley. He's long dreamt of bringing the paintings home. David is a direct descendant of Sir Robert Walpole.
How do you feel about some of them coming back and therefore recreating part of the, I suppose, the meaning of the interior as conceived by Sir Robert?
It will be extraordinary to see the pictures back, something we've always thought about and dreamt about but never imagined possible.
Well, how did this project start, bringing the paintings back?
When I first took over from my grandmother in 1990, I discovered these drawings of the picture hang in Sir Robert's desk in his library, showing two or three of the rooms as they were hung probably in 1743. So it was a project of a picture hang. So this was enormously exciting because we could actually see where things were, where the Rembrandt was, where the Rubens were. And you know, from there, the excitement grew and the project grew.
So today, it's these remarkable diagrams from 1743 that provide the crucial evidence to reconstruct the original look of the house.
You have the Grinling Gibbons portrait by yes. Kneller here.
Yes.
Which, of course, is placed with the Gibbons wooden surround.
Right.
In the common parlour. And the Teniers' kitchen scene.
They're coming back and they're going to go where they were hanging in the 1740s.
That's right.
Well, how exciting when you found these, though, in the drawers. I mean, they're now in mounts for to be framed, but they presumably they were just simply folded up.
They were folded up, exactly, at the back of the drawer.
Good heavens.
I think placed there by my grandmother, but she never told me about them, so it was an extraordinary discovery.
What's fantastic about this, of course, one takes it slightly for granted, but this is incredibly important, rare documents.
Yes.
To have 18th century picture hangs... designed and preserved as designs, and then the painting's name, so you know exactly what went where. I mean, this is really an amazing discovery.
Amazing document, isn't
amazing
it?
Amazing document.
Fascinating. Yeah. These drawings are a fascinating record of 18th century taste. A faithful picture of Houghton Hall as it was before the collection was lost. So how on earth had circumstances conspired to cause Houghton to lose its great collection? The beginning of the sorry story is revealed by Sir Robert's son Horace, who wrote of his father falling deeper into debt and despair. Horace recorded how he'd come across his father in tears in the library.
Constructing this temple to the arts had crippled him financially. Sir Robert admitted to a neighbour that it had a cost around £200,000. That's over £37 million in today's money. As Horace said of his father, his fondness for Houghton had endangered Houghton.
In 1745, Sir Robert Walpole died. And by the early 1750s, the house, the collection, and, inevitably, the debts, had passed to Sir Robert's grandson, George. George Walpole, or Mad George, as he has come down to posterity, became, in the words of his uncle Horace, the most ruined young man in Britain. George, alas, was his own worst enemy. Horace later described him in less forgiving terms. The most selfish man in the world. He loves nobody but himself, yet neglects every view of fortune and ambition. He drinks without inclination, has women not without inclination, games without attention, is immeasurably obstinate.
Under the stewardship of George Walpole, things went from bad to worse. He was profligate, impressionable, prone to bouts of insanity. He surrounded himself with hangers-on and was only interested in pursuing his own pleasures.
It would be Mad George who set in motion a series of events that led directly to the sale of Houghton's great art collection. But a problem for George was that Sir Robert's dream of shaping national taste had, in part at least, come true. In the years since his death,